Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Can you all hear me okay? And is it okay if I sit here? Would you rather I stood up at the lectern? Are you okay? Good, that's fine. Thank you very much for coming today to the annual review of NHS Forth Valley. It's really great to see such a good turnout today as well. So I express a great deal of gratitude for you taking time out of your schedules to come along and contribute to today's review. My name's Aileen Campbell. I'm the Minister for Public Health and Sport. And we've spent a number of meetings today discussing a whole host of different issues around the performance of NHS Forth Valley. I've had meetings with the Area Clinical Forum. I've had meetings with the Area Partnership Forum as well. And most recently, and just ahead of this public session, I met with the patients group as well. And we've discussed a range of different issues of concern, of wanting to highlight good practice, things around the way in which patients are dealt with in a local setting, ways in which we can improve the communication with people who have a degree of communication difficulties and challenges. And also we've really heard the very strong partnership working that goes on across Forth Valley in terms of the work with other local authorities and other agencies and partners to ensure that we have the services that people expect across the area. We've also heard lots of areas of innovation, lots of areas of piloting new ways of approaching issues of challenge. So for instance, we've heard lots of good stuff around the community pharmacy, the Pharmacy First project. We've also heard about some of the good partnership between GP surgeries and paramedics as well. So we've heard lots of innovation, creative thinking, good partnership as well. And we've also heard lots of good feedback from the patient group as well, and areas in which we and the Scottish Government can take things back to influence and shape and hone the way we develop national practice as well. So this is an opportunity though to hear from you directly from the public and to make sure as well that we are informed when we go into our private session with the board as well, that we can further drill down in some of the issues that require a wee bit more discussion, a wee bit more overview of how we can make sure that the performance of this board goes and develops in the way that it has done at the moment, which is in a really positive sense. So I'd like to introduce, from my point of view, the Scottish Government delegation. We're joined by Christine McLaughlin, who's the Director for Health Finance, and Alan Hunter, who is the Director of NHS Scotland Performance. We're also joined by Jane Grant, who's the Chief Executive of NHS Forth Valley, and also the Chair, Alec Lingston, who I think is going to chair today's proceedings. So I'd like to hand over the chair to you, Alec, to do your presentation, and then we can open up to questions from the floor, and hopefully we'll have a good going session. We've got an hour or so, and I'm looking forward to hearing your views, your concerns, your issues of, that you'd like to highlight, and looking forward to a good, robust discussion as well. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister, and a very warm welcome to you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming along to our 2016 annual review. The format of this afternoon is basically about a question and answer for yourself. I'm going to give a brief overview, which will be very brief. I want to look ahead to our new healthcare strategy that we've actually just launched as part of that. There's a lot of information in the pack that we've supplied you, so I'm not going to repeat things that you already know, just give you a flavour of what we're about. We never forget why we're here, and that's to serve the population of Forth Valley, give them the best healthcare we can within the resources we've got, irrespective of people's age or actual need. We have clear values that we've worked up with our staff to drive our operations, and we believe if our staff display all these values in their dealing with patients, then we'll be delivering excellent and responsive healthcare services to our community. A bit of context, we are a huge organisation. We deal with large numbers of treatments day in, day out. It's a huge undertaking, takes quite a bit of managing. And there are certain things that drive us as an organisation. The first one is quality and safety. It's making sure that people get the right care in a safe environment. Now, that's easy to say, but we are dealing with a lot of sick and ill and weak actual people. As part of that, making sure that patients at the centre of everything we do, there's a good patient experience. Again, that's challenging given people's needs, but we'll put a lot of work into doing that. Also, health improvement. Best thing we can do for people is keep them out of hospital. So we do a lot on health improvement in early years. We engage with our staff, we listen to them, we work with them, we train them. We need a highly skilled and competent workforce if they're going to deliver the completed treatments that we deliver to our communities. And as the Minister says, we very much work in partnership with other agencies to enhance our healthcare service. So that's at the heart of everything we do as a health board. Turning to quality and safety, we have our own quality strategy. The government have a number of national programmes. We're very much linked into that, learning from good things that are developed in other parts of the country, the actual world. We have our own leadership group that continually keeps quality and safety under review and drives that forward. The government have a Scottish Patient Safety Programme. There's 10 essential ingredients in that, and these are all incorporated into all our treatments and procedures. We have a very strong focus on infection control. We are dealing with a lot of ill, weak people, and it is quite easy to pick up an infection in hospital, but we're continually keeping on top of that so that we reduce it as much as can be. Also, make sure our hospitals are as clean as they can be. There is a government agency that inspect our premises. The last visited Clackmannan Community Hospital earlier this year, I'm delighted to say we got a very glowing report, and that's been the standard we've set. In terms of the public, the hospital standardised mortality ratio is the thing that proves to the public how safe our operations are, and we have a very good score, and that's continuing to improve. So everything we can do to make sure that people get a safe, efficient treatment, we are actually doing, very much alive to new ways of working, better treatments, learning from others. Patient-centred care, again, is at the heart of everything we do. We encourage patient feedback and we act on what people tell us. We start every board meeting with a patient story. And one of the gentlemen who's in the audience, he gave us a presentation on the Alfie things. And that keeps us actually focused on why we're here as a board. We work with patients and the public. We've got a very active and efficient patient-public partnership and forum, and they help us improve patient care. They add a lot of value to the work we do. We have a board visibility programme where we go and visit frontline services. And I've got to say, these are very uplifting, hearing from frontline staff the way they're developing services to improve the level of service, to improve the time scales we deliver services in. So our person-centred strategy was approved in 2015, and the theme of that, what matters to you matters to us. And that's, I say, what drives what we're doing. In terms of overall health of Forth Valley, delighted to report that deaths from heart disease, strokes and cancer is continuing to reduce. We're lower than the Scottish average, so well done to everybody for looking after their health. We have a strong focus on prevention, particularly addiction, alcohol, drugs and smoking, but also we're also investing heavily in early years and national strategies like detecting cancer early. And one I'd particularly like to mention is immunisation. We had a presentation to the board a few months ago, and I think we all found that very, very informative. I think none of us were truly aware just how many vaccinations she can now get. There's been quite a bit of development in that over the years. And we have a very good take-up rate in West Lothian. Our staff go out to promote vaccinations. As I said, best thing we can do is keep people from getting a condition in the actual first place. And we'll continue to actually push that while our take-up rates are good. They're not 100%. Until we hit 100%, we're going to continue to push it hard. But again, very innovative what is actually available. Staff engagement, as I've mentioned, high priority for us. We need a highly motivated, adaptive workforce if we continue to meet good quality, relevant services. We invest heavily in staff training. We have Investors in People Award at silver level. We're the only health board in Scotland that have it at silver level. We have an annual staff awards. We started that 3 years ago. And it's really great for us to actually see it firsthand, the innovations that staff are bringing out to improve treatments, improve patient care. A very uplifting experience. Our absence levels are below the Scottish average for health boards. In terms of efficiency, I think we are a reasonably efficient board. We hit all the government's financial targets last year. We're investing heavily in computerised systems. It's the only way that we can improve patient care if we can control meaningfully all the high volume of people we actually deal with. Last year, we made a presentation on the changes we're making in primary care to take account of the national shortage of GPs. We described in two of the practices where we were forced to take over the run of these practices. We brought in other professionals, mental health nurses, pharmacists, physiotherapists and such like to support the work the GPs done. These two practices are still very, very successful, and we're getting very, very good feedback from both staff and patients using them. So that will be a model that will get rolled out in the future as we experience more staff shortages within GPs. Now, all is not perfect in the health board. First to admit that is a challenge. The waiting times, the government have very demanding waiting time targets for a whole range of things. We've invested heavily in our waiting times to improve them over the last few years, and we're pretty good. This year they've slipped a wee bit as we adjust to changing actual budgets, but again, a lot of efforts being made to ensure that we deliver our services within the government's waiting time targets. One service where we haven't done well over the years is in mental health. Again, we've invested heavily in that. We've increased our staffing complement by over 40%. But as we've been recruiting staff, we've been losing staff, so it's been one step forward, one step back. We've reorganised a lot of our pathways, make them more efficient. There's been a 32% increase in activity. So while we're still, our performance is still not very good, I'm confident with all the investment we've made and the changes that we've actually made, we will very soon get within target on that. So I can give that assurance. Hopefully I'm right. Another area that's a major challenge for us is emergency care, the four-hour waiting time targets. Two main reasons for that is variable number of people who turn up at accident emergency. One day you can get 170, next day you can get 250 for no apparent reason. And just dealing with these big variations in numbers. Again, when the hospital's very busy, we have high bed occupancy rates, again we can struggle to fit people in. But again, we're doing a lot of work to try and improve our performance there. We're looking at supporting particularly elderly people with with long-term conditions who are high users of emergency services, supporting them in the community so that they don't need to come to hospital so often. And one example of that is the ALFIE project advice line for you, which has proven very, very successful with the actual public. Sorry. One other area is delayed discharge, getting people out of hospital who need ongoing care support. And that's a major challenge, but again, it's a major priority within our IGBs, and we've got a number of initiatives on that to hopefully get that under control. So it's certainly getting a lot of attention. Particular areas for action in this year, because the demand on the health service, the high cost of actual drugs, the challenging waiting times, we are having to make efficiency savings of £26 million, and that's going to be a major challenge. We've also got the ongoing challenge of waiting times and drug costs and new drugs that actually come on. So these are areas that are getting a lot of attention so that we can continue to deliver high quality services. And I want to turn looking a bit at the future. We've just agreed a new healthcare strategy covering the next 5-year period up to 2021. Even though I say it myself, it's a very ambitious strategy. It won't be achieved easily. There'll be a lot of hard work that will go into it. In your pack, there is a summary booklet. I'd encourage you to read that. And the full strategy is on our website. So, again, encourage you to look at that. The case for change is quite overwhelming. If we don't continue to change the way we deliver healthcare, then waiting times in the future will just get longer and longer as more people need to use our actual services. One of the good things about modern medicine is enabling people to live a lot longer, but a lot of these people have long-term conditions that are putting a huge both work strain, financial strain on the health service. So we have to keep reinventing ourselves if we're going to be relevant to our population. The strategy is very much clinically owned and led. We set up 8 different work streams, and these were led by very experienced and knowledgeable consultants that help shape the future. But also we run a lot of public consultation, both with general public and staff, to get their views. And very much what public and staff told us has fed into this actual strategy. So it's very much a people actual led. It's not people like me sitting in a darkened room saying, I think we'll do this, I think we'll do that. It's basically what people have actually told us about services and how we should develop in it, and very much building in best ways of doing things that we can pick up worldwide. There's 10 key priorities. Again, not a lot of surprises in that, and that was quite reassuring that the public are generally content with what the health service is actually delivering. We just need to adapt it to deal with the actual scale that's coming through and the new treatments that both are available just now and will be available. Health is a very fast-changing world. Included in the strategy is a number of health, a number of case studies, and that describes what we're trying to achieve through the strategy. So if you read nothing else, please try and find the time to read the case studies and say, is that the health service that we want to aspire to in Forth Valley? Hopefully the answer is actually yes. If it's not, we've got it wrong. But I think we've listened very carefully to what people are saying, so hopefully you'll agree that's what we should be aspiring to. So what will this mean locally? Well, we have the integration of health and social care, and that will ramp up. And over the next 5 years, it will be a virtual team that will be delivering. The public won't see a difference between health staff or council staff. It will be a virtual team that will be delivering a patient care. More care will be delivered at home or closer to home, and hopefully that will take pressure off the hospital, particularly emergency admissions. In the future, you could be seen by a wider range of professionals, pharmacists, physiotherapists, mental health nurses in the community, rather than just a traditional GP. We'll be encouraging people to take more responsibility for managing their own conditions, and technology will help us to actually do that. We hope there'll be fewer emergency admissions so that we'll be able to devote more resources to deal with planned treatments. People will stay in hospital longer, so we'll need more support. Stay in hospital shorter periods, so we'll need more support in the community to support people who need that. We'll be continually looking at how we use our resources, so we're making best use of the resources we have. And we expect that there'll be better patient experience and fewer complaints. So that's the aspirations we've set out. As I say, will be very challenging, but we're all up for the challenging. So working together, we can make sure that the health services in Forth Valley reflect the needs of our communities. So that's all I'm going to say. It was a very brief overview. The Minister, myself, would be delighted to hear your questions, your comments about how good or otherwise we're delivering services in Forth Valley. Thanks very much for listening. Okay, who would like to ask the first question or give the first comment?
I didn't hear anything about transport and public transport being included.
Okay, you know that we've been working hard with our local authority colleagues around public transport. There are issues, particularly in the rural areas, where we've been involved in some discussions, and also in Clackmannanshire we've been obviously heavily involved in some of the discussions with local colleagues to ensure that we are delivering public transport. As part of our clinical service review, those issues have been raised and will be part of our ongoing discussions about our new healthcare strategy and how we ensure that access to services is important. We do need to work with other colleagues, because in some areas we're not the lead person, but we need to work with others to make sure that services are accessible to patients and their families. So that's what we're doing just now. We've also done things like open visiting to make sure that we are more accessible to visitors as well, and that it isn't such a narrow window, and that's been pretty positive, and that's been introduced so that people can do that. We're also looking at patient-focused booking to ensure that that's now implemented in most specialties, to make sure that people have a choice of their appointment time if possible. So if there are issues, that we can dovetail and make our service more person-centred, that people have that opportunity to choose appointment time. So there's quite a lot of issues around the area that you've raised.
Richard?
Can I just start by thanking you, Chair, and when I was the MSP locally, they were very open and responsive to the questions which I was asking on behalf of constituents. I've got two questions today. One is on the area which the Chair, you quite rightly addressed as one of the rather poorer performing areas, that's child and adolescent mental health services. A level of, in your bullet paper today, 39% of patients being seen within the 18-week target. And I just wonder if you could outline what
additional measures you're going to take, because although I recognise that the number of staff have been increased quite significantly over the last year, I think it was said to be 40%, the number of staff in this area, and particularly psychologists, is well down on the Scottish average. It's only 60% of the Scottish average in terms of psychologists. And really, children, you know, not getting seen is really pretty vital for the families. In addition to which, 5% are not being seen for over 35 weeks, and there's 2.5% not seen till over 53 weeks. And I think for children to have to wait that long, really, you know, unless there's some very valid reason, there's a problem. And the last part of this that concerns me is that that 100 out of the 488 referrals to the service in the last quarter reported to March 2016 were rejected. And now this is a term used in the Information Services Division statistics for patients who are referred to the service but are then presumably signposted on elsewhere. But when that sort of number are being signposted on elsewhere, either the referral pathways are not working, or not being used appropriately, or something's going wrong, and we have no idea locally or nationally what the outcome on these rejected referrals are. There are 6,000 children referrals a year in Scotland where they're not, we don't know the outcomes of this rejection of them being referred to the central service. So my central question is, you know, can you tell us a little bit more about what further development you're going to undertake to meet the services? The other question is a very short one. One of the issues I raised repeatedly over 10 years was the having a very full osteoporosis service. For a long time, patients in Forth Valley had to go to Clydebank for their scans. I know we've got scanners locally now, but can you tell me, have we now got a full osteoporosis service preventing fractures, secondary fractures, etc.? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'll give a brief overview of what we've done, then I might ask Gillian Morton, who's the General Manager for CAMHS, to answer that, and Tracy Gillis, our Medical Director, to give some additional information around osteoporosis. So you're right to raise the CAMHS service. It has been an issue for us, as you see. We have worked hard, as the Chairman has said, to increase our staffing establishment and also to increase substantially the number of patients who have been seen, and we have done that. We have had some staffing challenges in the sense of it's quite a small service, and so therefore people coming as we're recruiting them, some people have left. We also have seen a very significant increase in referrals, and that is also one of the challenges that the service is facing in terms of redesigning to make sure that the services we're delivering are actually tailored to the patients who most need them. And I'm sure Gillian will pick up the question you've raised about rejection, because that is part of the overall redesign of the service. In terms of osteoporosis, it has been an ongoing issue for some time. We have made some progress in that, and this year the board has put as part of their annual plan the need to have a full osteoporosis service, and we've made some progress on that, and there's still work to do. So rather than me rehearsing all of that, I'll just point to Gillian, we might give us some, and then maybe Tracy, if you don't mind. Thank you.
Thank you. I suppose it's been quite a journey for us in CAMHS. I started there about a year ago having a look at the service, and one of the things we did was we put in a new model which worked for a few months, and you could see the RTT actually increasing. But actually what that did was it produced a bottleneck, so we then sat back, did a full scale redesign of the service, and that actually started in April this year. So the RTT is now going up. You would expect that to go up significantly every month. I don't recognise some of the statistics, sorry, that you were quoting about having a child waiting 53 weeks. We've got no one on the sort of list that's waited as long as that. However, in the system, it's just not there. We're not happy that we've got children waiting 26 weeks, never mind waiting 53 weeks, but we are working towards that. And part of the thing about the RTT when it dipped to its lowest, which I think was 16%+, was about us actually taking all these children who were long waiters and seeing them, which meant that we were seeing less children below 18 weeks, but it happened because it was the right thing to do, so we've done that. But as I say, the whole redesign thing has been done, we started in April, we will see a difference. The staffing thing's been quite a challenge because when you get that amount of money, it's quite difficult to get all the staffing. And at the same time, other boards were doing exactly the same thing. So, you know, it's a buyer's market out there. So eventually we got staff. But what we did notice, a lot of our own staff were promoted into these posts, which then meant that, you know, our own staff then had to wait till the next round of jobs to get a post. So that took us longer than we would have liked. We've done a lot of work around about job planning. We've actually met with our at the GP sub, and we've been working with the psychologists and the local authorities as well to make sure that the model actually fits as many people as we can. We recognise that we've had a lot of rejections, and that's actually started to decrease. We did some work about patterns of referrals, and also we're on Sky Gateway, so it means that it's much easier to actually get the referrals in. And what we hope to do was to give people information about redirection of things, not just a blanket, oh, you know, that's not an appropriate CAMH referral, because we thought that wouldn't be helpful. The team have also done a lot about redesigning the website and also developed an app. So there's lots of things that have gone on to give sort of families and sort of children some sort of self-help, which is actually sort of really good for people at that stage. One of the other things we did was job planning. So we've just finished our job planning, so we're able to better meet demand and capacity. And today we're having a sort of conversation about when our next sort of hill is, so our next mountain to climb, and that'll probably be in about 10 weeks' time, when again we've got quite a lot of the fellows compared to our demand. There's a mental health team nationally who are in to support us, and they're supporting all the boards, and we quickly got in there. I think we got the email at 17:05. I did respond at 17:06 to say happy to have your help. And so we've already met with them several times, and that's been really good. So what we're hoping that they'll help us with is about data and about how we get the ability to predict you know, where we will be in the next wee while. But actually from now on, if it had been sort of 3 or 4 months ago, I'd have been less optimistic than I am now. Now it's a very positive story. We'll be telling CAMHS over the next wee while.
Thank you, John.
Sorry.
Okay. The question on osteoporosis, maybe.
Thank you. So just regarding osteoporosis, you're right, that has been a gap for us previously. We do have DEXA scanning available locally. One of the issues around the siting of the scanner is the room is not as accessible as we would want it to be, and we found an alternative place to resite the room. We have people trained who are able to report the scans now, so that's a positive step forward. I'm very pleased that we now have a fracture liaison nurse in place, as that's one of the important components when people have a fragility fracture, is to be able to see them and to make sure that we're able to follow them up and offer appropriate therapy. And the next step will be for us to develop specialist resources for those who are intolerant of the normal oral medication, to be able to provide infusion oral medicines as needed. But we have reconfirmed with tertiary board partners that they are able to provide that for us at the current time under the existing arrangements until we have our own service set up for that. So I'm very pleased that we should have that service fully established.
Thank you.
Next question.
I'm Helen Maguire, and I'm representing the Clipman and Shire Older Adults Forum. And I wanted to take up Jane Grant's point about the work that's been done taking clinics over to a Clipman and Shire Community Hospital. We're very grateful to you for carrying that out, and we wondered if there were any plans to take anything further over. One of the issues that we do have problems with is that a number of patients have to travel from Clipmannanshire to Falkirk Community Hospital for a cataract operations. They're not allowed to drive because of the operation, and there is no public transport to Falkirk Community Hospital. They don't get patient transport, and they therefore have to depend on someone taking them and going back or waiting to collect them. They may be there for 4 hours because it's a block booking, it's not scheduled the appointments. And so this has raised the question of, again, bringing things back to the community, and our community has got this wonderful new hospital. Is it not possible for them to have the cataract operations carried out? I believe there is an eye clinic there, it takes place at the moment, but I think it's for children. I don't think it's for anything else. But if we could know if you're bringing anything else further to Clipmanan, and if you could consider cataract operations at the Clipmanan Hospital.
Okay, thanks for that question. As you know, we have repatriated a lot of patients to Clacks Hospital, you've said that, and we've tried to work hard on that because actually it is easier for patients to access services. We've got to balance that with it's not just about the consultant or the person who's there, it's also about the infrastructure around that, and that people need to see specialist nurses, they need to see EHPs, they need to see a variety of people. So we're reviewing our outpatient services at the moment because of as the chairman has said, we have some challenges around access. So certainly that journey is not finished in terms of what might go to community hospitals. I think the cataract one is a slightly different one, and it is more complicated. As you say, we have a centralised service in Forth Valley for cataracts at Falkirk Community Hospital. To reprovide that locally would be pretty challenging in terms of trying to put theatre time and so on into community hospitals. So I think that is a more challenging debate. There are things we can do, though, I think, around, as you've described, people having to wait and we can be more person-centred, I think, around the service we do have there. And certainly the points you make are well made, and we can take them on board and think about how we can accommodate some of the patients who are travelling from further away, because that is difficult. And as part of that, we have been looking at, as I said in the previous answer, trying to give appointment times that are more suitable for people. Clearly, there has to be a lead-in time. You can't come at, so there are issues that we can deal with there, but I think the cataract surgery going into Clacks Hospital would be something that would be very challenging for us at the moment.
If patient transport even could be provided, I believe it is provided for people going to the Glasgow Hospital at Golden Jubilee, if they have to go out to another board, there's patient transport provided there. If it were possible to provide patient transport to Falkirk Community Hospital for patients having to travel there, that would be an alternative.
Yeah. So patients at the moment have the ability, should they require it, if they meet the criteria for the ambulance service, then the ambulance service will take them. I think it's those other patients you're describing which is more difficult. It would be difficult for us to commit to that today, frankly, because there will be a number of patients there. However, I think we will look at whether we can be more person-centred around access to Falkirk Community Hospital. I'm not sure if any of the other team members want to contribute to that. But it is a difficult one in terms of trying to balance access and transport for patients. It is difficult.
Sorry, Graham Foster, I'm the Director of Strategic Planning, is one of my roles here, so I was very involved in the healthcare strategy, and I just wanted to make the observation that one of the things that the public said very strongly to us through the healthcare strategy process was the challenge of elderly people, increasingly frail people, coming repeatedly to hospital, and that's a message that we've very much heard. So we are looking at things like, for example, trying to reduce the number of times that people return repeatedly to highly specialist clinics, because people often have several different conditions, and we're looking at perhaps having clinics that can deal with several conditions at once, so that the number of visits is actually reduced. When you see the volume of activity that the health service has to provide on the slides that were up there at the start, clearly for us as the NHS, it's not possible to do all the transport for that as well as providing the services. But what we can do is try and reduce the number of times we need you to come and see us. And we'll do that by having these joint clinics. And it's also one of the reasons why closer to home is one of the big things in our strategy. So we'll try and provide more and more services out, either in primary care or in the community hospitals. And that's, you know, a big message in that strategy.
Thank you. That's helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you. I don't know if it's really a question, but twice I've heard about staff coming and leaving. And I'm on the public patient panel, so I'm very much aware of the problems about staff coming and leaving. And one of the things that does concern me is we have the Golden Jubilee, we have hospitals in Glasgow and Edinburgh, etc. people who are looking to advance their profession will go to these hospitals where they're going to get a wider experience. And it concerns me that because Forth Valley Hospital is a fairly small hospital, that they can lose out in getting the best of staff for this hospital, or indeed retaining them. And this was said right way back when the hospital was built. If it had been a training hospital or something like that, it would have attracted and kept the staff. And I just wondered, I'm not sure whether you can answer this, and perhaps it's Mr. and Mrs. Campbell who could perhaps give me some enlightenment on that, please.
Maybe we could give a little bit of the local context first, if that would be helpful. So when we talk about staff coming and leaving, it's not the same staff who are coming and leaving. It's actually retirals and things like that. So it is a movable feast, the kind of staffing establishment. What I think is more difficult in some of the areas, we have a small cohort of staff and they are quite specialised, and that does become, you know, if one person leaves in Glasgow and they've got 30, then that's not so challenging. If we've only got a smaller number, that does become more vital. However, I'll ask our Director of HR just to give some views about the staffing overall, and Angela Wallace, our Nurse Director, is just going to talk a little bit about her area, where she manages quite a lot of the staff, if that's all right.
Okay, thank you for that question. And I think, first of all, I'd like to reassure you that the staff who work in NHS Forth Valley are a highly skilled and committed group. And also pleased to confirm to you that we're in a positive position in relation to the recruitment and retention of our staff. And just a couple of examples of that may well be helpful. We do regular surveys of our workforce, and in our last survey, we were very clear that an additional 13% of our staff from previous reports had said that they would recommend NHS Forth Valley as a good place to work. And our interview candidates regularly confirmed to us that Forth Valley has a very good reputation. So we have historical low turnover. I think our long service awards absolutely show that. We are committed to the training and development of our workforce and have examples, as you've heard from the chairman, of innovative services and change. And we are very clear that Forth Valley provides high standards of care from across all of our sections of our workforce. Final point before I pass over is that there are, of course, areas where there's challenges in recruitment. But the challenges that are faced are challenges across Scotland, not just challenges that are specific to NHS Forth Valley. So hopefully that's helpful.
Thank you. Angela? Thank you.
Wanted to support everything that Helen said in relation to nursing and midwifery, which is the largest workforce. We are able to both attract and recruit and retain. There are, just as Helen says, there's a couple of pockets that are tricky for everyone to recruit to, and we would be in amongst that. But even considering that, we will do well even with the much bigger boards. We are a training organisation, and we do lots of training both for a whole range of our staff working here, and work really well in that regard. And often our staff do go and work in other areas, and you often find they will return, they've maybe enjoyed the experience. And where our staff choose not to leave, we try and make sure there's as much enrichment and stretch as we can to keep them here, and we have people who tend to want to work and live in Forth Valley, and that's a huge strength.
Maybe just to add that certainly in the kind of course of the meetings that we've had today, and the kind of the evidence that we've heard from the colleagues on the board, that hasn't been as big an issue for, I think, Forth Valley as it has perhaps for some other boards that are sandwiched between either Glasgow and Edinburgh, for instance, Lanarkshire or Ayrshire and Arran, where I did the most recent review, where they're in the very, you know, the so close to Glasgow, and the kind of the competition they're almost having to face between attracting people to choose their board to work. So
both boards have got their own innovative ways of trying to entice people to come there and showing the kind of broader holistic benefits that people can get through choosing to live and work there as well, not only in terms of them personally and for their own career development, but also for their family and the lifestyle that they can have. So boards are trying to find their own ways in which they can bring the best people, but also I think it's important to recognise that the people who are working in all of the boards across all of Scotland are incredibly well-trained, educated, and are really good at what they do as well. And it's not just a case of the best being in a particular board, because actually we've got a really good suite of practitioners and professionals across the whole of the country, but there is challenges there too, and I think, you know, everyone's recognising, for instance, the very well documented issue around GP recruitment and retention is well documented. It's not just an issue for this board or for Scotland, it's across the whole of the UK as well, and from a national context, national perspective, the government is taking forward some bits of progress and bits of work to try and find ways to ensure that people know that entering into to become a GP is a good and viable career option, as opposed to going down other paths, more link up with other colleges and universities and other places around the country to make sure that people do choose to become a GP. And in my own constituency, in my own patient group, in my own town that I live in, they've even gone to the local high school to see who's interested in studying medicine and got them on board in their patient group to try and ensure that they can maybe find ways to entice them to come back and be a general practitioner. And that's just a very, very small example, but it's one that's probably doable amongst the patient groups across a whole host of different communities as well. So there's a whole suite of work, local, board level, national, to try and cope with the challenges that, around staffing across the country.
Thank you very much. I am well aware that Forth Valley worked really hard and that the staff here are excellent. That was not a criticism. But you did touch on something which I am a bit concerned about too, because I was in education. And 2 years ago at Larbert High School, there were two pupils I knew of with 5 A passes who could not get in to study medicine because there were no places left. And I would like to think that's something the government's looking at, that there are enough places for training.
Well, absolutely. It's about looking at every kind of point in which there's an issue that we can overcome, a barrier or a challenge to be addressed, and making sure that we do have that longer term planning, as opposed to just reacting to a particular challenge, that there's a much longer term plan of action in place. And that's when I was mentioning some of the activity that's going on around at the universities and the training, the new ways in which we're trying to incentivise the career choice of becoming a GP, which I don't think has always been the case. So there are lots of bits of work getting done in the hope that in the longer term, the medium to longer term, that these challenges that are current at the moment are addressed, and also some really innovative local examples as well. But the other thing is that nobody's standing still, and people are trying to reconfigure the services at the moment so that people don't feel the impact of some of those immediate challenges that we face. So we've been hearing around in Killin paramedics working with GPs, we've been hearing about the Pharmacy First, we've been hearing about ways in which actually really positive outcomes have happened in the face of that very real challenge, and actually it's very patient-centred, very patient-focused, and delivering well for people as well. So I think it's about making sure, though, that these events like this, though, allow you to challenge us, make sure that your views are heard and taken forward, and that we respond adequately to it.
Thank you. There's another question. Oh, yes. Oh, sorry.
Yes, in terms of partnership and integration, what can you do to support unpaid carers at home to be recognised as equal partners in care at all levels?
Okay. We've been doing some work through the integration joint boards with carers, and we have spent a lot of time in the health board looking at carers as well. And we have got representatives of colleagues on the integration joint boards, and the chief officers are here and might want to help with that answer to that question, if that's all right. So, Shiona, are you something to...
Hello, my name's Siona Strachan. I'm the Chief Officer for Clitmanshire and Stirling, and it's a very good question. In a round partnership with carers, we're working very hard across our partnership area with the carers groups. Carers are part of the strategic planning group and are taking a very active part in that, and there are some representatives here today. So a very, very clear voice from carers in the planning and in the delivery of services and the feedback loop that we have. They're also on the Integration Joint Board in terms of active membership, and again a very, very clear voice in and around the style and the delivery of services. If you look at the strategic plan that we are all working to and the services are all calibrated to deliver, the carers' issues are very, very strong in the middle of the strategic plan, and that was a very, very deliberate move in our partnership area to ensure that the partnership was actively recognised. In terms of service level delivery, it's about ensuring that our pathways and systems always take account of carers, and that our training programmes again re-emphasise the need to work along with carers very, very actively in designing and delivering services for people and with people.
Patricia, do you want to add anything?
Thank you. I'm Patricia Cassidy, the Chief Officer for the Falkirk Integration Joint Board. Really, Shona's covered most of the work we're doing across the partnerships, but obviously there's a national carer strategy that's been developed, and we have been updating the Integration Joint Board on that and preparing with our colleagues across the partnership for the implementation of that as a key piece of policy that we'll be implementing.
Thank you.
And I was just going to add as well, though, that the carers legislation was passed just ahead of the Scottish Parliament elections, and so now our job is to implement that bit of legislation, and that falls now in my portfolio too. So there are a range of different ways in which we need to kind of make sure that we're engaging with carers. Some of that's done through this Carers Parliament. For the young carers, we've got the Young Carers Festival as well, and also taking cognizance of some of the new powers that the Scottish Parliament is getting around the payments that carers can get as well. So the carers legislation, though, I think is an important one for people to be mindful of, because in the enactment of that bit of legislation, we'll have to go out to consultation and make sure that we're getting the right views and opinions from carers across the country to ensure that the pledges made in that bit of legislation are brought to life in a positive sense for you as well. And there are other things as well that we probably might be able to talk about after this session, if there are particular things that you want to raise around self-directed support and other ways in which people can be innovative in how they cope with their caring duty. And there are other things as well about the rollout of that carer positive communities and things like that, to make sure that the whole country is made very much aware of the huge amount of work that carers do on a daily basis, every day through their lives. And the other thing that I'm kind of interested in as well, about the point in which people's caring experience ends and how they cope with that as well, and about how we make sure that that's seamless for them, and how we can help people cope getting back into society and supported into doing that in a seamless way. So I'm happy to maybe speak to you afterwards as well, if you want to kind of let us know some of your views, your thoughts around the national implementation of that legislation.
Yes.
Thank you. How much time and money is spent on medical research at Forth Valley? The reason I ask is because I've just been to the festival where Joan Bakewell was talking about the programme, which you all have heard, inside the Ethics Committee, and that's coming to an end because they can't find people who are prepared to go on the radio to express their happiness and unhappiness in respect to research. But I'm interested to know how much time and money you spend.
Okay, our medical director will answer that. Thank you.
Thank you. So I have research and development in my portfolio, although it's not only medical staff undertaking research, it covers all our staff groups, and the total budget is about 5 million. I don't know if you wanted to ask anything else about that, or I would happily pick up with you more detail.
You're going to have to go to an ethics committee.
So we are part of a nodal structure across Scotland that's under the auspices of the Chief Scientist's Office, and our Research Ethics Committee sits with Tayside and Fife, and it's run jointly between those three boards.
And how often does that meet?
It meets every 2 months on average, and then there's an annual report that comes to our Clinical Governance Board, which has just been for the last year, that summarises that activity.
Thank you.
Hi there. I'm a member of the deaf community, so I guess I'm representing some of their views. And we recently had a talk from the Alfie group. And I guess for deaf people, this can pose some challenges, because if you want to contact Alfie, you can only do so via the telephone. So my question is, as a deaf person who use a sign language, how do I make contact with Alfie? Now, I realise that the government have set up Contact Scotland, which is a video relay service, and that is very helpful. And some people will use that, those that use technology, but for deaf people that perhaps don't use technology, what other ways could be used for them to be able to contact Alfie?
Okay, thank you for that question. We had a little of discussion of that at the patients' meeting, and I think we recognise that that is an issue for us. And what we've committed to do is look at a wider range of and variety of ways in which people can access that service, because clearly there are issues which were elegantly raised at our previous meeting. So you're right to raise that. We recognise that we need to be more innovative around how people can access our services. And so we've committed today to take that away and look about how we can publicise and change our or augment our service so that everyone has an ability to access it in an appropriate manner. So we've given that commitment, and we will do that. We will follow up on that.
Okay. Yes.
Have you any immediate plans to speed up the waiting time for the cardiology clinic in Labatt Hospital? An echo scan was carried out. 5 days later, the referral was made to the clinic, which was excellent. But the appointment time for the clinic is not until the 22nd of September, which is a waiting time of 21 and a half weeks. If any treatment is required, then that's going to be further down the line. So your 12 or 18 weeks target times are blown out of the water.
Yeah, thank you for that question. We have some difficulties, as the chairman has alluded to, and our outpatient waiting times at the moment have been higher than we would like. We have invested quite a lot of resource in trying to bring them down, but it has been variable, and we have seen increasing demand in some areas. So we have a whole outpatient programme at the moment looking on an individual specialty basis about what staff we have, how we can be more innovative about patients being treated more quickly, about different roles for staff, and so on. So we're working hard to make sure that every specialty has got a revised plan with additional resource, both in terms of consultants, but importantly as well in different roles and different people delivering services for patients more quickly. So you're right, we have got some challenges around that, but I would assure you we are working hard to try and address them.
Any other questions?
Good afternoon, my name is Alec King from Bowness. I'm just wondering how many of the foreign nationals we have on the staff at the hospital, and I'm hoping it's not a time bomb just waiting to happen if the Westminster government get their way.
Yes, so we have been looking at that, and we have been trying to make sure and reassure our staff, because we value all of our staff, whether they're from wherever they're from. So we have been working hard with staff, and we're not envisaging any significant dramas around this locally. However, we are part of that bigger picture, and I think it's yet to emerge what some of the implications of that might be. But certainly we'll be doing everything in Forth Valley to reassure our staff that we value everyone's contribution. I'm not sure whether Helen would want to add anything to that, or Tom Hart, who's our employee director, perhaps, and I don't know whether the Scottish Government might answer some of that. But.
I'm sorry if I didn't catch all the question. I take it was looking for reassurance around the EU nationals that are living here. I'm so sorry that I didn't. I'm assuming that was the question. The government, after the referendum result, government wrote to a number of EU nationals, particularly working in the NHS, to make sure that they were reassured that we had a complete commitment to doing all we can to help them through this point in time. The other week as well, the First Minister led a public meeting in the back of a special cabinet that invited EU nationals to attend so that we could hear directly some of their causes of concern, their anxieties around the implications of the Brexit referendum result in June. And I think what the point is that we try to make is that the implications aren't fully yet understood, I don't think, and we're still wanting to work with the UK government and still looking to explore all the different options that Scotland as a nation has as well. But certainly our first and foremost commitment was to make sure that people from different European nations who have chosen to contribute and live and stay in Scotland know that the Scottish Government and actually politicians in general are behind them to try and do what we can to support them, because we rely, it's about 5% of the NHS workforce, I think, are from EU countries around Europe. And so we have a real duty to do what we can to help support them, and we'll continue to work and engage, liaise with NHS boards, liaise with whoever we need to try and ensure that they are given the security and confidence that they need, because they are contributing fully to the good running of our NHS and our country.
Well, I'll try to speak a bit clearer this time.
So it was just the mic. It was just the volume. No, if you could hold it a wee bit closer, that would be great.
I'll choke on it. No, the question, I noticed you mentioned Brexit there, but this motion was put forward by a certain Mr. Cameron and Osborne and all his cronies before Brexit. That there's about 14,000 nationals in this country, sorry, foreign nationals, and they're determined to get rid of them. But it was prior to Brexit.
Maybe I can catch up with some of these issues afterwards. Certainly know that the in terms of EU nationals working in the NHS, the EU referendum was the huge cause of concern, and a cause of concern for people who didn't even work in the NHS. Just in general, if you're living and working here and you're from another country in Europe, that it's caused a great deal of anxiety. That's why the First Minister led the public meeting to try and gauge and get a sense of some of the kind of causes of concern. It's huge, and it possibly even links into some of the points around research as well, because we rely on an awful lot of research funding coming from Europe as well. So there's an awful lot of unknowns. This is unprecedented times that I think that we live in, but we're having to work through as best we can, provide as much support to the people who are from European countries working and living here, with families as well, to give them the reassurance that they need, and the confidence that certainly the Scottish Government is doing what we can to support them. And I can pick up some of the more specific points that you had around the world before Brexit later on after this meeting, if that's okay.
Thank you. Margaret Gilmore, Patient Public Involvement Panel. I wanted to ask, because it hasn't been talked about in a lot of detail, but obviously £27 million savings for this health board, multiplied by 14 other health boards, is a phenomenal amount of money and a huge challenge. Mm-hmm. And I just wondered how you're actually going to achieve that.
Okay. Everybody's waiting to see what I'm going to say. Okay, I'll pick up some of the basics of that, and then our Director of Finance might want to raise, and maybe I'm not sure if the Scottish Government want to answer that or not, but certainly we've been working hard at doing a systematic review of everything we have, and we have tried to look laterally at some of the areas, things like energy usage, and our use of temporary staff and so on, and our prescribing budgets and things like that, we've tried to do in a systematic way. Are there things that we can do differently? And it's tantamount to the staff and this board, actually, that they have been positive about their interaction of redesigning services, doing different things, having different roles, and recognising that we must live within our current resource. And that is the life we lead, and that's the job that we have to do. Fiona might want to talk a little bit more about some of the detailed work we're doing, because we are doing a lot of work to make sure that our financial position is stable, because that's absolutely essential to the board moving forward.
Yeah, Fiona Ramsey, Director of Finance. Just to build on what Jane said, I think there are a range of areas, prescribing being one. It's one of our highest spend areas. Looking across the different categories in terms of hospital prescribing, in terms of GP prescribing, what can we do differently, how we target best, how we use our resources in these areas. The chairman mentioned the HEPMA system that we're introducing. That's just one example of us that links to our prescribing budget and the resources we're using, but also as an example of us using technology to try and help us deliver savings. And we've got a range of other projects in that kind of category. Jane's mentioned temporary workforce costs and making sure we've got staff, our employees in post at the right place, right time, so that we don't need to rely on that. And we've got good results so far in those areas. I think we heard this morning as well the input from staff, and we've got a range of ideas that come forward from staff about how we can use our resources differently. If everybody, I use the example all the time, if everybody can save £500, that we have a lot of staff, so if everybody's got an idea like that, and people can see things when they're out there, we're trying to reduce as much waste, variation, etc., and we're also looking at benchmarking. So if we are higher in a particular area, then that's the one we'll go and look at. I think it's fair to say 26 million is challenging. I can't say it's not, but we've made good inroads, and we have got a good track record of doing this with everybody working together.
And we understand, amongst all the hugely positive work that's going on in this health board and other boards as well, that the financial climate is challenging. It's climbing for the Scottish Government in a national sense as well. However, we've provided an uplift, a real terms uplift to boards as well, and done what we can to try and protect the health budget. And Christine will say a bit more. In terms of what we're expecting, we're trying to redesign and refocus a huge amount of public services across the piece, primarily a focus on preventative actions as well. You know, a huge amount of my portfolio brief includes things like obesity, smoking, alcohol dependency and misuse, a whole host of things that we reckon are preventable, and trying to tackle some of those things in a way that avoids people having to use health services in a more costly way. Not only costly to the NHS and the public purse, but costly to them and their own health and their own long-term outcomes as well. So there's a huge amount of work happening around how we can avoid some of the more costly interventions later on. But that's only one part, because we're kind of mindful that while we're trying to do all that prevention and early intervention, there's still a huge amount of things that need to be worked on and dealt with, and crises that have to be coped with at the moment. So what we're asking is very tough of public services, and what we expect, I think, as a country is quite challenging as well. But I think it's the right way to approach things. And what we've been hearing today and across the whole of the country as well is that while there's been services redesign happening, actually what we've been finding and we've been hearing today is that some of those are providing far better outcomes because of the refocus, the reshift in ways people are treated are actually providing better outcomes. So it's also about making sure that those things aren't just done in a monetary sense, but making sure that they're patient-centred, patient-focused, and that the outcomes are what we would expect. And that's also why there's the whole integration agenda, the social care and health integration approach, to try and find ways in which things are more streamlined, things are working more, are working better for the public than they might have been in the past. And that's one of the reasons, I think, why people when they pay their taxes, they pay into society, they don't really care who's spending it. They just want to make sure that the services that you get are being delivered well. And that was one of the challenges that the Christie Commission outlined to us, to make sure that we have public services that are fit for purpose and providing well for the public. So that's on a kind of national sense where we're hoping that we can try and cope better with the challenges, the fiscal challenges that are facing us. But what we've done in the meantime, though, and while we are facing these challenges as a government, we've tried to support and protect the NHS budget as best we can and provide that 5.5% uplift as well. But Christine, I don't know if you want to add anything.
So I think it's worth saying as well at your public meeting, the NHS Forth Valley has had a very strong track record in delivering your overall services within the resources available. In the last few years, it's been a very strong and solid position. And it's also important, I think, to focus on the total value of resources, as Fiona says, within Forth Valley, but making best use of the total, just under £500 million within Forth Valley. I think if the danger sometimes you focus too much on what you try to take out rather than necessarily how you make best use of the total. And there are lots of good examples within this board of doing that. But what's also different because of the magnitude of the savings is there's a lot of good evidence of regional working and national working to deliver savings. So it isn't just about what you're able to do within your own boundaries, but when you look across NHS Scotland, into IGBs and how you can work together to get better use of resources. So it doesn't mean that it's not difficult for this board, and there will be some things, decisions that have to be taken that will be ones that that will be fuel to some people, the decisions that you'd rather have not had to take. But I think there's a lot of opportunity in where we can go, and so long as we focus on looking nationally, there's a lot more chance that we'll get the savings this year, because it'll be roughly similar levels going forward that we'll be looking into future years. So it isn't just about delivering in this year, but getting sustainable services that can deliver over the next 3 to 5 years as well.
Sorry, it's me again. I just wanted to ask you, when you receive money from Europe, does it go to the Scottish Government and then into the Forth Valley Bank account, or does it go straight in from Europe?
I guess when I was talking about, that was more about the medical, that was about the research, I think, is what we're talking about.
I was interested in that as a different issue. But when you receive money from Europe, which is what you referred to earlier, yeah? I just wanted to know if it came to Scotland into the government, or whether it comes straight into the Forth Valley NHS account.
So there are different levels of funding. There's funding into the UK and through Westminster that flow, but there can also be funding for individual research projects that could be, I'm not sure if you have any, Jane, within Forth Valley, but if there's a particular research project agreed with Europe, then that would be an individual agreement with that researcher. But the large European funding is through the agreement in Europe at UK level.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Hi, my name's Cathy Carmichael from Bonnybridge. And I regularly go to see my GP. I go to the surgery. And I noticed recently that there was a sign. And I said to the GP that this sign that shows the numbers of do not attend, they should start fining people because they're such high, do not attend. And there was something like 300 a month DNAs. And that to me is just unacceptable and is a huge cost to the board. And so is there some way that there could be some penalty for people who constantly miss appointments?
Okay, so I shall give some version of an answer, and maybe others might want to help me. But we have started measuring this in a more in a more constructive way, in the sense of being more visible, because both within primary care but in secondary care as well, it is a real issue for us, and we have been looking at the DNA rates that people have.
I should have mentioned that too, but I'm sure it's the same in hospitals, so there needs to be more of an attempt made to stamp down on this.
Okay, we are certainly, and maybe one of our GP colleagues might want to help me with this, but certainly within secondary care we're looking quite closely at DNA rates. And why might people be doing that? Why is there something that our service is doing that actually is making it not easy for people to access? Because it is a waste of resource. And while we are trying to overbook clinics, then actually that becomes a more difficult debate. So we are trying to minimise that impact. And as I said already, we're looking at patient-focused booking and trying to allow people to choose when they want to come, so that actually they're proactively having that opportunity. And I know a lot of work's going on in GP practices as well to actually make it visible to people that actually where resources are stretched, then actually people having access and not attending then actually impacts importantly on other people.
Okay, she's responding saying, but this approach has been going on for some time now, we still don't see any improvements. And it's really, when are we going to start seeing improvements in seeing lower DNAs?
We have some of that is quite new. Some of it is quite new. So the patient-focused booking and our drill down into individual specialties has really only just been coming to the fore in the last few months. I don't know if one of my GP colleagues would like to just talk something about primary care, because that might be helpful. James, thanks.
Hi, I'm James King. I'm a GP in Tillicoultry. I think a lot of practices have a lot of different approaches to this. I think most GPs in Scotland are certainly of the opinion still that charging patients for non-attendance is counterproductive. And I'm saying that partly because of the experience of dentists who do charge patients who don't show up. And GPs often pick up the pieces of patients who then refuse to go to a dentist because they owe the dentist money. So I think it accentuates inequalities if you start charging patients for not turning up to appointments. There are lots of different reasons people do forget. Doctors' practices, certainly in general practice, sometimes don't cancel appointments when somebody's got an earlier appointment that's become available, and it then shows up as a DNA when the patient's already been seen. But I think the innovative use of technology, and certainly my practice now texting reminders to patients, and that has made a huge difference to the DNA rate. I don't know if you want to say anything, Stuart.
Yes, and that text reminder has been used more widely as well. Sorry, Stuart, were you wanting to say something else? Okay. So there is work going on. We recognise it's an issue, and we are trying to improve the visibility of it so that people really realise the impact of them not attending on other patients who are actually having to wait longer. So, Kathy, do you want to say something else?
Hi there. Just another example of how we're kind of trying to work as a partner with parents. So a nice example is speech and language therapy service for children, where we, when children are referred, the service invite parents to come along to an initial meeting, and they tell the parents about why they've been, their child has been referred. They talk them through the therapy, and they get their support to help with that, and then they ask the parents to opt in. Do you want your child to go forward for this therapy? And they have significantly reduced the DNA rate, and also they have got a lot of additional commitment from the parents to the therapy that they then receive. So that's quite a nice example where they have actually been innovative in the way that they've addressed that issue.
It is. Thank you.
I would like to ask the government if, in light of all this financial difficulty, if you have looked again at any other way of charging for some prescriptions.
Well, the reason that we got abolished prescription charges is because we believed that they were a tax on ill health, and actually the cost, the bureaucratic cost of administering the system was counterproductive. And so we believe very strongly, certainly this administration believes very strongly in keeping prescriptions free.
I know the lady brought up about doctors and non-attenders,
but the nursing non-attender is absolutely appalling.
I guess it's the same kind of issues, isn't it? It's trying to make sure that people understand the impact of them not attending is actually making other people having to wait longer. So it is the same kind of issues. So we are trying, as Cathy has said, we are trying a number of initiatives to try and raise the visibility of the impact, but also to make people, in essence, responsible for their own behaviour where they can. There are some instances where, as James has described, things go awry, but actually quite a lot of our DNAs are for other reasons, so we need to work with people in an individual kind of cohort and make sure that we've done everything we can and that people understand the impact, whether they be doctor, nurse, AHP or anything, you know, because it does make other people wait longer.
Warwick Mason. Talking about DNAs, a lot of the notices come out for clinics saying phone and make the appointment, the patient-focused appointment system. If you have made that appointment, you really have entered into a contract to turn up or phone and cancel it. I've spoken to too many people who seem to say, it's all right, they'll send me another appointment. If they have confirmed it, why can't they then cancel it? Should that then be go back to the end of the queue and they won't miss another one? The other point is, with the letter coming out asking you to phone, you have made the contact. A lot of people are finding trouble in getting their letters. I've raised before the problem with TNT, that second class service is about 5 to 7 day delivery. If you live in a rural area, you might be a little longer. But I think this is where we have, as people, to take responsibility. There's no point complaining we can't get appointments. We, every one of us, have to be responsible for our health and for making these appointments, cancelling them or otherwise. Mm-hmm. If we cancel, we will be offered another appointment. If we don't turn up, I think that's penalty to put you to the back of the queue if you can prove that you have been notified originally. And that's why the patient-focused, please phone, confirm the appointment, get your date and time. You have said you'll turn up. If it's illness, yes, people can understand that. But too many are missing. It's not everybody taking ill. So I think it's up to the public to help their own health service.
Okay. I think we're working partnership to try and make sure that we've done our bit and that people contribute. So I think we would continue with that kind of person-centred approach, which understands that sometimes life intervenes in these things. Yeah. But actually, we do expect people, when they've confirmed an appointment, to either turn up or contact us and say they can't, and then we can reappoint someone else. So I think it is you're right, it's a two-way dialogue that's required, and we're working hard to improve that.
I wonder, I've lived 23 years in London, in the southeast, and the health authority that I was under was, I think, the first one to declare bankruptcy. There were 14 years of the main hospital, which had taken up the slack from all the different smaller cottage hospitals which were closed. And a very interesting thing happened, which in the mid-90s was that the community health councils, which were made up by people who were experienced but retired, who were excellent at getting things done between the patients and, you know, the services as they were changing. Laterally, I developed a number of different things for which I needed operations. And I found, because I had been a nurse trained in the Highlands in the 70s, I was easy enough to write my own introduction of the basic points. And I began simply asking, would it be all right if I were to fill someone who hasn't shown up shoes? And then this became a bit more popular. And I found that by having my details already written out and all the contacts and things, that the various places which I needed to see were delighted to have me. And so I began recommending this to other people. And I think that the other point about this is that my landlady, who had epilepsy and a number of things, suddenly became very unwell. They thought it was CJD, and so she deteriorated quite rapidly. And she required a number of different things at a very short space of time. But although she had that disability and neurological problems, she was very gifted in languages, and she was an author and translator and an foreign language teacher and so forth. And so we got together. I said, you know, this looks to me like this is going to be a long haul. If you would write what your symptoms, because we're going to be asked the same things everywhere, you know, that I accompany you at this stage. And so I did that to the delight of all of the staff, including the ambulance staff. And they said, if every patient could come with this, what a relief it would be. So I would be happy to show you the documentation and see if something could be developed.
Okay, that would be helpful. Angela might want to just pick up some of that.
That was really, really helpful, and I think every single thing we do, communication is something that we do well and something that we continually learn from, and that seamless track of information, and we're getting much, much better with electronic systems. And I know some of our medical staff, and Jane mentioned earlier around open visiting, so when someone has been admitted and families there to give collateral information, have made such an impact on terms of diagnosis. We know patients and families worry about information transfer, especially when they're coming into hospital or coming in contact with services. So it sounds as if you've got something really fantastic there, and I wouldn't mind if the audience and everyone's comfortable that we maybe chat at the end and get the example. And it sounds as if you've got a group of people thinking it's fantastic, and we would certainly love to build on that and build with the other things that we're doing around communication. So if you wouldn't mind, I'd love to spend some time with my team finding out about that.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Recently, at home, our old fax was having problems, and we've been fortunate over the years to have good correspondence with our health centre, and normally they would fax and let us know that we could go for appointments and different things. But just recently, they've stopped using it, and I know that deaf people now are using text messaging and things, but recently I went to the reception at the health centre and they said, oh, we're no longer using the fax. And they said, you can call us. And so I said, well, how about texting? And they said, no. So I know that this is perhaps a localised issue, but I just wonder, from your point of view, if receptions could have a mobile whereby deaf people could communicate with them using SMS, texting, because if we can no longer use a fax machine or other methods, then we can't really communicate. And I appreciate that sometimes staff can't use their own mobile phones, so whether or not there was a number within surgeries that was a text SMS number that would enable us to communicate more effectively with GP surgeries.
Okay, so we heard a little of that at the previous session as well, and we give a commitment to look at that. There's a couple of people we'd like to assist here. Stuart, and then Tracy. Thank you.
Thanks. Yes, it's an important... I'm Stuart Cumming. I'm a GP and Associate Medical Director for Primary Care, and it is an important thing that we need to consider. One thing that we are sort of trying to look at just now is how patients can email practices. We have, most practices have practice websites, and some of these practice websites have got two-way communication through email, and we also have each practice has a generic email box that we we can answer queries on. It's the sort of email box that we get our out-of-hours reports on, so it's checked every day. And I think that's probably the way that we're focusing on rather than text messages, because it allows a better, it allows better security and it allows a better two-way dialogue. And then we can perhaps respond to your queries in that way.
That's fine if you use email and you're familiar with that. I don't. And so for me, the only way I can really communicate now is SMS and text messaging. For deaf people, that is their means of communicating with each other, or for many, many deaf people. And simply prescribing medication and different things like that, I appreciate I need to make the effort to go to the reception or to the pharmacy and things, but to make appointments things, then to text would be far easier. Just a couple of months ago, my husband, because he couldn't contact the pharmacy, went all the way over to the pharmacy, was told it wasn't ready, had to go back home, and we're sometimes making multiple visits because we've not got a way to communicate with the pharmacist or with the surgery. So that's just one example.
Okay. I'd say that's something that we could take away and think about that.
We heard a bit of that this morning, and I think we've committed to looking at the kind of range of issues of communication which people have raised with us. So there are a number, and that is one of them. So we will take that away and have a look at that.
Sorry, I was just going to say, so we would want to get our e-health clinical lead involved in that. And it's not well known, but there is a way to do text messaging through NHS mail, but many people don't know about it, so we could get that GP clinical lead to commit to making sure that all the GP practices knew that was available.
Yeah, that would be helpful, actually. Okay.
Okay, so that all the questions? Okay, well, we'll maybe wind up this session before I pass over to Minister Christie. Thanks very much for your comments. We really appreciate, as I said in my presentation, we want to put patients at the centre of everything we do. We need the feedback from you to help us do that, and we've received a lot of good comments both in this session and the previous session with patients to actually help us. So thanks very much for that. We will look very carefully at all the things you've actually suggested. I'll now pass back to Minister.
Yeah, thank you. Just like Alex said there, thank you for taking the time out of your days to come along here today and not just coming with issues of concern, which is rightly, this is the right forum to raise it, but also coming with ideas and innovations of your own to try and make sure that the health service provision in this area can be enhanced. So from us in a Scottish Government national context, some of the things that you've suggested, some of the things that you've raised are really important, and we'll take those back and hopefully build on the contacts that we can make today about how we can further enhance national policy and that engagement with you, whether it's on carers' issues or in a whole host of other areas of work that we're taking forward. So thank you for coming today. Thank you though to everyone who's attended all the different meetings that we've had so far, and I should have pointed out as well, this morning we had a really fantastic visit to the paediatric ward at the Women and Children's Unit as well, so we're getting to see firsthand some of the great work that's going on in a real life sense as well, and the transformative work that's happening in the hospital for young children and young people in Forth Valley. So thank you again. Please though do stay in touch with us if there are things you want to raise. There's going to be a number of consultations no doubt as well. Just keep an eye on the Scottish Government website, and please don't make this the only point in time when you contact the Government, that you have to have this ongoing dialogue to make sure that together we can create the services that we want and the services that you deserve as the public. So thank you, and thank you to Forth Valley.